So a lot of us think that life looks like this, a line. This is the past, this is now, and this is our future right here. It's a very linear way of thinking. This is how we've always think. You know, we're just on a timeline because that's all we can perceive. Life isn't just a straight line. So you probably think that your life looks like this or like this. But really, our lives are like this. It's far, far from linear. So if you see this and you mesh with other people's this, then you just have a big blob, really. And it just becomes more noise, more static. And if you look at that, or if you just think about that as your visual interpretation, then just think about how can that create the space you need in order to find yourself, in order to find that peace, in order to find that freedom, or in order to grow. So seeking minimalism to me is just making this a little bit more harmonious and less out of control. Maybe like this. So seeking minimalism to me is about focusing on my path and what I can do to it, what I can do to have fun with it, instead of letting my emotions, instead of letting my thoughts run and control who I am. I get to be more conscious and aware of the process just by focusing on what it is that I want to experiment with. And for this, I want to experiment a minimalist lifestyle. I took down some notes so that way I can make sure I cover all of these topics. And so the first thing I want to go over on the exterior cleanse, that is my physical health. So after the majority of the emotional purge, and the reason why I say the majority is because it's always ongoing. It's never gonna go away. So after you finish one stage, don't think that you can jump to another, and just know that it's gonna be around. Some of these underlying issues will come back up and, you know, get you when you least expect it to. But overall, when you take care of the one big thing that has been really, really holding you down, you're able to have less weight and put more focus onto other things that you really want to try out or do for yourself. I was able to focus on my fitness. I was never an athletic person or an active person. I didn't like walking a lot. I was never a hiker. But I've always wanted to learn martial arts, and that was my door. So I was in this new town. I didn't know anybody, and I work from home, you know, making YouTube videos. So it wasn't a great lifestyle to meet new people. And I thought maybe if I go out and learn something I've been wanting to learn that is active, this will give me, you know, an excuse to get out and also stay healthy and active. So I thought about martial arts. And so I found a Krav Maga school. I couldn't decide like what kind of martial arts I wanted to learn. But with Krav Maga, it's kind of like a mix of different martial arts. So I thought that would be a great way for me to start. I started, you know, learning the basics, and there was like some kickboxing involved. A lot of martial arts school nowadays integrate in like different cardio workouts to train and condition your body. And so there were lots of conditioning work going on. And that was a really, really great foundation and start for me. Yeah, I learned some great skills. I learned how to really throw a full punch, jab, cross, you know, like kick, really, really kick hard. And that really trained my body. I lost weight and I felt a lot stronger. And oh my goodness, I found a whole new kind of confidence. I remember I was walking to the supermarket, the Whole Foods or something, from my apartment, and I was just like walking outside and I was like, I just feel so confident. Like, oh my gosh, I can kick ass. Like, just, I was a little bit arrogant, but I felt really, really good about myself overall because I felt strong. I never felt this way before, you know? And so that was me in the moment. So I have always had problematic skin, lots of acne. I had like all sorts of different acnes, you name it, you know, the little bumps, blackheads, and the, you know, big clusters, cystic. It was always an issue for me throughout my whole life. I always suffer from bad skin. Now that I was working out more, my pores were sweating. I stopped wearing a lot of makeup because I know that I would need to work out the next day. And also the fact that I stopped creating videos. I used to always wear thick makeup, a lot of makeup in my videos because I was just trying to cover the blemishes on my skin. I was trying to make my skin look nice. And so sometimes I would make my eye makeup more dramatic because I wanted to take the attention away from my skin. Since I was filming less focus on filming, you know, and more of working out, my pores were sweating more often. And so I just stopped wearing makeup most of the time. I would just wear it when I'm going out or special occasion. And I was also very tired of just taking hours to do my makeup. I also updated on how I do my makeup and play around with different looks. I was just more into the eyeliner, simple eyeliner, get my brows done, a nice lipstick and blush, but not so much of like the fake lashes and all that kind of stuff. Like I was so addicted to fake lashes back then. So because of wearing less makeup, I noticed my skin was getting a lot better. I also want to add in the fact that I started doing facials, but that was like once every 2 months. So I don't think the facial really played a huge role, maybe a little bit in my skin. But overall, I think it was because I was wearing less heavy makeup that made my skin clear out. My skin is not completely like perfect, I would say, but it is a lot better than it used to be. So I would say it's because I stopped wearing too much and I stuck to something that was more simple and enjoyable. So if you notice, many of the clips that I've shared with you are piles of clothing, and that was because I used to love shopping for clothes. And I just, when I started YouTube, I started buying more because I felt like I needed a new top for every new video. I also thought that I needed the latest trend. I thought that I needed, you know, the latest whatever was up and coming. I thought that I needed it. And so shopping was quite an addiction, and it was a very hard, difficult habit to break, at least for me anyways. Year one, I still was ordering and also tempted to buy certain trendy items. I still did, but not as much. I would put more thought into what I was purchasing, like how is this going to affect my space? Do I really want to bring this home into my space? Do I really need this? Or I would buy things, hold on to them, and take more time to think about them, and then I would return these things when I realized that I would not be wearing them in the next few weeks or so. That was what helped me kind of like wean off of that habit of just purchasing things. I would hold on to them until I realized that I don't need them, then I would just go and return them. It was very, very difficult for me to not buy clothing because I always thought that I needed these new clothing in order to, I don't know, find some validation. Like, oh my gosh, I need this. I would look so, you know, it would look so nice on camera, whatever it is, whatever my logic was at the moment. But I was able to put more awareness and mindfulness into how I was shopping and what I was bringing into my space. You know, a lot of people say social media is toxic, which I do agree with, but I also think that it's a tool. And just like with any tool, like a knife is a tool. If I give you a tool, if I give you a knife, if I give someone a knife, it really depends on how they use it. They either use it as a weapon or they either use it as a tool that will help them become more productive. And with today's age, you know, with today's modern society, you know, we can't think that we need to live like cavemen again, or we need to live like how we did back in the days, because we're always evolving and we should understand and utilize the things that we have today in the best way we know how to. That's what I believe. And so with social media, instead of just demeaning it or thinking that it's going to ruin our lives, social media is like a tool, you know, just like a knife. You can either, like back then, you could use a knife to survive, or you could use that knife to hurt yourself. With social media, you can do the same thing. You can either hurt yourself, or you can really use it to utilize it in a way that just you can bring more value into your life. So there are accounts out there that provides value by teaching you something new, inspiring you. And then there are accounts out there that's looking for validation, that wants you to feel like you're not enough. I like to look at it this way. There are takers and then there are givers. Just like in real life, there are takers and there are givers. So when you are about to clean your social media feed, you're going through all the people you're following, think about who are the takers and who are the givers. The takers are the people who post up photos and they want your validation. They want your likes, they want your comments, they want your interaction, and they want your engagement. So that way it can make them feel better about themselves. And then there are people who are the givers. They are inspiring you. They are informing you. They are, you know, just trying to provide to other people, giving back to the community, just trying to create a better, healthier world or lifestyle. And so that's kind of for you to decide, you know, when you're going through these, your social media feed, if going through your Instagram feed or Facebook, whatever it is, make you feel worse about yourself, really think about who are the givers and who are the takers. And also apply that onto yourself. Are you a giver or are you a taker? You know, are you giving back? Are you, you know, providing value to your audience? Or do you just want validation? Do you just want that like? So all while I was working on my physical health and also working on my shopping habits, I was also decluttering. And I would say decluttering was the easy step to all of this. And it was kind of fun too, because decluttering was more visual and it was more about the obvious things that were right in front of me. So I would break it up into three parts, you know, what I can sell, what I can donate, and what I need to throw away. And so sometimes when you just look around you, you can instantly find things that you need to donate, sell, or throw away. And this is the easier step, I would say, within my journey to minimizing. When it comes to decluttering, you can take your time and you can systemize it in a way that will work with you. For me, I took time with each space in my home. So I would either work on the kitchen one day, and then I would work on the bathroom another day. And if the room is overwhelming, then I would just work on a certain corner. Like maybe I would work on just the closet and then later the bedroom. So it doesn't overwhelm me. And I think most people tend to feel overwhelmed and so they just stop altogether. But something I think that would really get the momentum going is to just declutter with the obvious things and just pick a spot and then work on another spot another time when you're ready. I actually find it to be very therapeutic to declutter. I would turn on a nice podcast or a video, like one of those long, lengthy video, like this kind of video that I'm making right now. Like I would turn this kind of talking video on, like as if somebody's talking to me, and I would just organize, work on my stuff, like, you know, clean up my closet, fold my, you know, clothing, do the laundry, and I would just play like a YouTube video or a podcast. And it's just so you know, just so relaxing. I love that so much. If you could just change your habit, the way you used to view things, it will really help you to kind of look at things in a whole new light and maybe in a more positive way, especially when it comes to making your life better. Another great tip for people who usually get overwhelmed when it comes to organizing or cleaning is to have a miscellaneous box or basket and just put everything that you don't know where it belongs to in that miscellaneous basket. And then later on, you take that and then you compartmentalize it into wherever it needs to go. All right, so this next one I want to focus on is simplifying. Simplifying, when you focus on that, is more so about asking yourself questions and making things less complicated. For instance, for me personally, the dishes. I hate cleaning the dishes, or my kitchen is, the dishes are always piling up and it just stresses me out. Every morning I look at my sink and it just looks a mess. It's always messy. I don't know why. And then I realize, I ask myself, how can I simplify this? And really all I had to do was just stick to the essentials, things that I really need, things that I use often. I really just need two or three plates and maybe two bowls, or, you know, have a few forks around. I really don't need these extra mugs. I tend to collect mugs. I love collecting cute little mugs, and so they pile up, because when I need a clean mug, I would just pile my dirty mugs in the sink. So really, life can be a little bit more simple depending on how we really think and process stuff. So if you have problems with dirty dishes, maybe it's time you simplify that and make it less complicated. So whenever something seems annoying, sometimes when it seems overwhelming, then I take a step back and ask myself, how am I making this so complicated for myself? What can I do to simplify this process? What can I do to simplify my life altogether? And then that's what helps me to think of different solutions. Well, Anne, maybe if you have less of this, or maybe if you organize this in a certain way, or maybe if you put this here, life would be a little bit more simple. So I would say during my level 2 phase of seeking minimalism, I finally realized and kind of put more focus on essentialism. So minimalism to me became essentialism, and I focus on the things I really need. So during that phase 2, I was kind of discouraged with minimalism. I felt like it was becoming a very unhealthy way of thinking. It seems more to me of just a aesthetic lifestyle, a trendy, you know, thing of the moment. And so I was kind of feeling discouraged about it. I was just like, well, you know, this really has no meaningful, it really doesn't hold any valuable meaning to me anymore. What is this really? What am I doing? And that idea of minimalism evolved to essentialism. Instead of focusing on an aesthetic lifestyle that I need to live by, like, why can't I just simplify down to, you know, a couch and a table, that's it. Like, why can't I live with, you know, without all these things right now? But instead of just thinking that I need to go from 1 to 10, I am accepting the process through essentialism. So whatever is essential to me at the moment, I am living with that. And whatever I really don't need at the moment, or I don't need more of, then that is how I'm able to differentiate or distinguish between what I need and what serves me and what doesn't serve me. So for instance, I still have a lot of furniture in my home, but instead of going out to buy new furniture, you know, getting the latest, greatest, new trendy furniture, I stuck with the furniture that I have. It's essential to me to have them at the moment. Instead of focusing or thinking that, oh my God, I have too many things in my home, I'm not becoming the minimalist that, you know, like, that I think I should be. Instead of thinking that way, I just focus on, hey, why don't I just, you know, keep these old furniture instead of going out buying new furniture, and just, you know, use it until they're no good anymore, or until I don't need them anymore. In fact, I actually just sold my old sectional and my dining room table. So I'm really happy to just kind of get a new fresh start, and I'm not looking into buying anything new or replacing those with any new purchases at the moment. I'm just looking to kind of like getting rid of all my bulky furniture because I'm thinking about moving, and I really don't know if I want to, well, I don't want to rush into buying anything new, but I feel ready at the moment. And back then I wasn't ready to, you know, get rid of all these furniture because they were essential to me at the time. I needed a section, I needed a sofa to kind of like have a room to relax in toward the end of the day with the family. You know, it was very important for me to have some family time. And during COVID, during quarantine, it was really nice to have like a different space to kind of hang out in. And I'm so glad I didn't get rid of it because I thought I needed to fit a certain aesthetic. So those were all the exterior things that I have been working on. Some I have been working on simultaneously with others, and some it was like a gradual like shift and change. I go through stages in order to become more aware or change my habit, you know. When you create a habit from not being conscious of it or being aware of it in the past to being aware of it, it's quite a journey and it's quite a challenge to kind of shift your mind into a newer way of thinking. You know, it doesn't happen overnight. It's quite challenging, I know, for me, and it definitely takes some practice to really get my mind into a new way of thinking, into a new way of living. Although things may not be perfect as I would hope for them to be, sometimes I question myself, like, what the heck am I doing? Or am I doing this right? Or, you know, I really feel like I'm getting nowhere with this. But really, whenever I look back, I'm just like, wow, I'm so proud of myself. I've come pretty far. And sometimes it may not look like it. And I have to remind myself of all the amazing things that have happened already. It's so weird how it's so hard. Well, for me, at least anyways, it's so hard to be reminded of all the accomplishments that I've done in the past. It really takes some resetting and, you know, like a whole new mindset to remind myself of my accomplishments. And that is my physical health. Like, I was able to find a whole new confidence through that, through learning martial arts and at the same time becoming stronger. And then my skin, like, I never had like no acne before. It was just, it's so amazing to feel like, wow, like finally my skin is clear. Well, not completely perfect, but it's a lot better than it used to be. And I feel a whole new sense of confidence. What I've learned about social media is that it is a tool. It is a tool that is relevant to today. It's a tool that's going to stick around. It's something that we can't avoid, something that we can't hide. It's something that is going to be with us, that is going to follow us into the future. And if we try to ignore it, then it's just going to become bigger and just haunts you. Anything that you try to avoid will haunt you until you face it and stop being afraid of it. And so when it comes to social media, don't let it intimidate you. Use it like a tool that will help you in life. Differentiate it, differentiate the kind of people that you follow, who there is a taker and who are givers. And also ask yourself, are you a taker or are you a giver? It's a community for us to coexist. So try to provide value while you're also taking value. Simplifying is such a great way to recognize your behavior. So if something seems overwhelming or just complicated, instead of thinking about or focusing on the problem, think about the different solutions that you have and how you can make your life so much more easier, and instead of just complicating it. Lastly, essentialism. Instead of focusing on what I strive for, I am focusing on what serves me at the moment. I hope that you enjoyed today's video. If you do, and if you would like to support, I would appreciate a thumbs up, and also I appreciate your comments so much in my last video. I really did not expect that kind of just like interaction. Like, so many people were sharing their personal journey and stories with me. I'm so honored to hear your stories and to be a part of that. So thank you so much for following me on this journey. I appreciate you. I love you, and I will see you next time. Ciao.